for coming. Here's what we're going to do this afternoon. When we were talking about how to run this session, one of the thoughts was that we would decide in advance what we would do in breakout groups, that we'd have some presentations, and then we would decide essentially what problems to be working on. And we ultimately decided not to do that, which means we're operating without a net. Because what we really want to do is to get you all talking to each other and surface the ideas that are kind of implicit in the room. So what we're going to do is essentially in two parts. We're going to have a couple of people up here presenting ideas that are meant to be essentially conversational objects, things to get us started. And then from there, we'll have a sort of plenary discussion. We'll take questions and comments from the room. And finally, then we'll go into breakout groups, and we're going to ask you all to surface ideas that you think are practical but haven't been instantiated yet, things that could happen but haven't happened yet in applying these technologies to a development agenda. And then we'll have a report out to bring those ideas back. We'll also work with the rapporteurs to capture the ideas and to put them up after the fact for subsequent examination and editing and so forth. So that's the shape of the afternoon. Without further ado, let me invite the first speaker up. We're going to start with Steve. And are you going to do it from there? Or you want to do it from here?
From there.
Come on up.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, great. All right, let's grab my. Sorry. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Steve Fosloo. I'm the Fellow for 21st Century Learning at the Shuttleworth Foundation, which is based in Cape Town, South Africa. A lot of what I want to talk about today has actually been covered this morning, or alluded to, which is great, because it means I'm on the right track, I think. The point that I want to make today is that while access to information is critical, and nobody is questioning that, I think what we should really be aiming for is access to participation. And I'll spend the next 10 minutes explaining what I mean by that. So first, a story. In 2003, I joined as the usability team leader this e-government portal called Cape Gateway. So we provided access to government information and government services to people of the Western Cape, South Africa. It was a very successful project. We had three languages, English, Afrikaans, and Xhosa. The first trilingual e-government portal that we had come across in South Africa, well, in Africa. Three channels of access, the website, a walk-in center, a call-in center. We had won various awards, and by the time I left there, we had 60,000 pages of information. So two problems that we encountered a lot of the time was that, one, our information quickly became outdated. Imagine 60,000 pages. We tried to have contact details for very specific people. So to try and make access to government as transparent and as easy as possible. But people move on, their phone numbers change, et cetera. So that was one problem. The second problem was that often we would point people to their nearest traffic department and explain to them how to renew their license. But when they went there, they received terrible service or no service. So while their total government experience had begun well, they had the information, it had ended very badly. And obviously that was a problem for us. So what could we do about that? Please park that question. I'm going to come back to it at the end. So after Cape Gateway, I was very lucky to spend a year at Stanford University, which, as you know, is in the heart of Silicon Valley. A lot of Stanford alumni have gone on to found very successful IT companies, Google, Cisco, Yahoo. So for a South African who had been on dial-up connectivity at home, to spend a year at Stanford was mind-blowing. And it was here that I first began to understand what Web 2.0 was all about. So Tim O'Reilly had famously described Web 2.0 as various things, but one of them was it's an architecture of participation. And we all get that through user-generated content. So this kind of, you know, I really began to feel that in that place. A professor that I came across, Professor Henry Jenkins from MIT, in his book, Convergence Culture, and in this paper that I reference, he speaks about participatory culture. And it is a change in our culture, where we as a society are no longer happy just to consume media, but also to, we now want to participate in the creation and sharing of it. And if you look at the examples that he gives, it's very much around rich media creations, blogs, podcasts, games, fan fiction, etc. So I got that. And I guess after my year at Stanford, when I was going back to South Africa, the question that I was asking myself was, are we a participatory culture? So, and we, I mean, not just South Africa, but developing countries. Our technological landscape is vastly different. Our cultural context is different. We're behind technologically. Are we also behind in the way that we use the technology? So have we become a society that wants to participate? So I'd become taken by Facebook and YouTube and all things shiny and new and needing broadband. And it was very difficult to think of this context in that notion of participatory culture. I've spent the last year trying to answer this question, speaking to various people on the ground, practitioners all over the world, looking at projects in the ICT for development space. And the answer that I've come to is that yes, we are a participatory culture, but it looks different where we are. The desire to participate is exactly the same. The benefits to participate are the same. But our differences are as follows. First of all, it's mobile. So we know that, and that's been covered this morning. In just released statistics, we know that there are 1 billion people online through PC-based internet access. There are 4 billion people, roughly. And I know that the figure changes, but let's say 4 billion people with access to cell phones. In Africa, that's obviously particularly pertinent. In South Africa, we believe that 90% of the youth have access to cell phones. 9% have access to PC-based internet at home. So this is the device through which the developing world is going to participate. Participation is also about contributions and not just those rich media creations. So as an example, one could look at Wikipedia and say, this is a rich, time-consuming, very well-thought-through creation that somebody's put up there. This is a page. Not everybody who uses Wikipedia puts up a whole page. We know that a lot of people just make tiny edits, but some people take pride and create this little knowledge piece. This is a contribution in a developing country context. So this is Al Jazeera reporting on the war in Gaza using citizen journalism and using Ushahidi, which was mentioned earlier, which is a fantastic piece of software, which I would actually like to repurpose and use it for an alternate reality game in Cape Town with teenagers as they run around the city and find things. But so this is contribution on the ground, crowdsourcing crisis information, allowing people to send their information via SMS, email, a web form, and aggregating it in a very sophisticated and slick interface, but allowing that quick and easy participation on the ground level. Another example, and this is a new project, is Text Eagle, crowdsourcing the world. They want to tap into the 1.5 billion people who are mobile, who have mobile phones, who are literate in the developing world, and who could, for money, perform simple text-based activities. So this is a contribution in an economic development sense. So participation is also about involvement. It doesn't have to be a huge campaign where all the people create websites and tons of blog posts get aggregated and videos get sent in. It can be light and low tech. So Howard Rheingold, who wrote Smart Mobs, has given us many examples of how SMS is the simple act of forwarding an SMS and gathering in a place, in Spain, in the Philippines, can be used to topple governments and sway elections. So that is participation, you bet. It's simple, it's light, it's low tech. Participation is about connectedness. Typically, we like to think of connectedness like this. So Facebook is, the feeling is big. It has millions of users. You often have lots of friends. There are lots of ways on here that you can reach out and poke someone, send them some flowers, put up your photos, send them a video. It's a very rich rich and layered experience. Connectedness in rural Mexico looks like Project Zambido. A fantastic project that works to work against the social isolation that people feel with HIV and AIDS. So they broke people up into groups of 10, gave them cell phones, and said, talk to each other, using voice and text, create a support group. And they've had remarkable success on a number of factors, adherence to medication, a drop of anxiety, feeling more empowered about the disease. So it's small, it's low tech, but extremely powerful. So participation is also about conversation. This is a conversation happening for people with broadband. It's a YouTube video posted in response to another video. And as videos get posted in response to each other, a dialogue begins to happen. It's very interesting, it's very novel, it's great. Obviously, not everybody can have this kind of conversation. This is a conversation happening in South Africa between a grade 17 teenager, calls himself Sparkplug, and a university tutor who provides, through mobile instant messaging, provides maths tutoring on any subject in the school curriculum in South Africa between 2 and 8 p.m. every day. So it's not obviously as visible as YouTube, but it's very much participatory, very much conversational. So why participatory? Well, for all the old reasons. Obviously, it's inclusive. It leads to a greater sense of ownership and empowerment. And we know that these are very valuable qualities in a developmental space. So while participation is not new, it is now different. And with the social media that we have and the 4 billion mobile phone users out there, it is cheaper to allow people to participate. It used to be a participatory community development practitioner going into a community and holding not one-on-one group workshops, but it was expensive, time-consuming. Obviously, that has its place, but it now becomes cheaper, easier, faster, not just to develop systems to allow people to participate, but also to also for them to actually send in their SMS and to be a part of that activity. Obviously, it's much more visible, and it has the potential to include a lot more people. So these things lead to greater access to information, and that is really what we're all about. Dr. Chris Dye, had a quote earlier saying that we live in a world of unexploited information. And this is really what allowing channels of participation is all about. It is recognizing that there is a wealth of information at the bottom of the pyramid, and we need to allow people to send that data up to levels where it can be analyzed and processed, and then also circulate back down again, and leading to greater healthcare, greater education, et cetera. So to form that circle. Peer-to-peer learning across time and space, again, it's not just the practitioner, it's not just in one community. It can happen across time and space, and obviously that is hugely powerful. And these things lead to greater self-organization. And we know from a developmental point of view, there is huge power in that. I've just finished reading Clay Shirky's book, so I wanted to include this, that because of the social media we have today, and this is in Here Comes Everybody, the barriers to self-organization have collapsed. And that is what participation is all about. So coming back to Cape Gateway, for me, the aha moment was when I realized the question should have been access to information for who? Was it access to information for our citizens that we were providing? Or was it access to information for us that they had? They had experience with government. They had come across inaccurate data. And we hadn't given them an easy way to feed that information back to us. So in closing, I'd like all of us to think about, are we enabling access to participation in our projects, in our initiatives, in the way that we approach our developmental problems? Do we make it easy enough for people to participate? Do we make it safe enough? And obviously that is crucial in developing countries where there are repressive governments. Do you allow people to participate anonymously? Is it affordable enough? And is it meaningful enough? Is there enough of a feedback loop that people feel that their voice has been heard, that their contribution matters? Thank you.
great. Thank you, Steve. Questions for Steve after that? If you don't have questions after that, you're not paying attention. In the back, sir.
Thanks, that was a great talk. Just with respect to your last point, you're asking whether it's easy enough, whether it's meaningful enough. My question would be slightly different. Is what's the incentives for people to join in and communicate? We heard about playing games and talking to your friends and so on. Yeah. And one of the problems I mentioned earlier on was the difficulty of creating networks of people who go on interacting with each other indefinitely. And that's not so much about it not being difficult, but there has to be some real positive incentive, some real need, some real service that is being provided as a result of that. So I might be, just listening to what you say, I might be inclined to rephrase one of the questions, one or two of the questions at the end. But thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, it's definitely very challenging. It's often, especially within the world of communities of practice and knowledge management, it's often one or two people or organizations who want to create a community of practice, which is obviously very different from a community of practice emerging of itself. And so for us who want to create these things, we really need to think about what drives those people and what makes them tick. And it's a very good point. And I enjoyed Dr. Salvador's presentation of thinking about it's a system, and it's a complex adaptive system. And so what do we introduce that people will resist? And what are the social structures and the power structures? And how can you influence that group in a way that begins to make people want to participate? It's difficult. Yeah.
Got a question down in front. Yes.
Eric Hertzman from Ushahidi. So my question is on tools. Do you think it's possible to introduce tools from an aid or development standpoint? Or is it something that people use because it's already in their pocket, so it's usually a consumer tool anyway?
Yeah. I think both, for sure. If what you're offering is addressing their need, then the means that it gets achieved, I don't think that people focus on that too much. Obviously, you know, it makes a lot more sense to work with what people have got already. And I work in education in South Africa, and so we build computer labs. Well, the education department does. Kids can only access that lab for 30 minutes a week. But most of those kids have got cell phones, so we've actually got no choice but to look at that. But at the same time, if you introduce an intervention that addresses that need, yeah. I use Mixit, yeah. So Mixit's the mobile instant messaging service that little conversation on the maths tutoring, Dr. Maths on Mixit is all about. And that has a membership of 10 million. So a few million of those are in the 12 to 18 age group. And I've been talking to them about saying, well, let's look at cell phones as tools to develop literacy and language skills. And let's try and move past how texting degrades language. And obviously explore that and really kind of have a serious dialogue about that. But to look at a phone as a publishing platform. So to get Macbeth in short story form sent down to you and to allow kids to write pieces and share them and review each other and get that kind of hands-on participation. Yeah.
Can we get a microphone? Oh, I'm sorry, thank you. Here in the back.
What I noticed was you were it's Paul Stevers, Charity Help International. And what I noticed was that you were looking at really just your basic phones that do basic text. But my observation is that the smartphones are coming through in a big way. And in a few years, you're going to see the average kid having a smartphone, mm-hmm. you know, with that kind of capability. It might not be an iPhone, but it'll be something that can do much more than just texting.
Sure. Absolutely. And in South Africa, as an example, typically what happens is that wealthier people buy a new phone. The bulk of the population is on pay-as-you-go, and they typically get phones that people hand down to them. So as technology advances, the hand-me-down phone now is actually fairly sophisticated. and the hand-me-down phone in 3 years' time will be a smartphone. So it's just a matter of, you know, it's a waiting game. But for example, this Mixit application, that's a Java app. So that runs on GPRS. So we know that there are at least 10 million Java web-enabled phones in South Africa, which people often don't realize that. And it's true, a lot of the innovation, obviously, is as soon as that technology becomes mainstream, there's going to be huge opportunities.
Other questions, comments? Oh, sorry, yes. One more.
Yes, Henri de Cazotte from the French Development Agency. It's a bit of the same question that this morning. Our institutions work mainly on the web. I mean, we've been fighting inside our institutions to develop web platforms, and we're still fighting against the people who produce paper. Yeah. And so when you were talking to moving to the mobile, you know, I wonder, what should we do? Should we scrap the web?
Yeah.
And delete what we've been doing, fighting against the whole system to get the web as a development tool, and then go into the mobile. My question is it a kind of downgrading of what we've been doing on the web? Even on the web, people are discussing the quality of what we are doing. They said it is not scientific, that things are not as true as what is being written on the paper. So on the mobile, I mean, things will be reduced to very simple things, and not have the quality of content, the scientific content of what we should be putting on the technology. So I am a bit uncertain of where we should be going. For instance, did you scrap the CAPE platform?
No.
This had been thrown away by the South African government as being unsuitable, not informative, or outdated as soon as it was published.
Yeah.
So I'm not quite sure what you are trying to say is that what should we be doing? Is it a new industry that we have to build maybe and develop? Thank you.
Okay. That's a great question. Thank you. So absolutely not. The web is here to stay. So the web is the glue that holds the whole thing together, and the web will always be here. And people speak about it. You know, a PC-based web and a mobile web. There is only one web, but there are different ways to access it. And we have to realize that the 4 billion people out there who increasingly, as their phones become not even smartphones, just fairly basic phones that can do web access, they have a reduced view into our web or into the web. So the web is still the corner piece. We have to begin to realize that we need to allow people to look into it, and we need to customize our information and in a way that is mobile friendly, which is very important. And there's a lot of work being done for that. But absolutely, the web is here to stay. And it complements, you know, the cell phones complement a kind of full web experience. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we'll have more conversation in a moment. I want to move on. I want to pick up on what Steve has said, because so much of that is relevant. I'm going to do something slightly different. I don't come from the development side of the house. I come from the network side of the house. I teach at the Interactive Telecommunications Program at NYU, and Erica, Christopher, and I are working on a class there, which is designed to work out communications patterns, basically places where there is some leverage in the field that hasn't been taken advantage of yet. So I'm not really going to use this as a screen. I'm going to use it as the whiteboard I don't have. And what I want to do is walk you through 5 operations that I've found valuable when you're thinking about existing communications patterns, wherever it is, to ask yourself, if I'm doing X, can I do X plus Y as well? So here's the basic unit, right? And I draw these intentionally as people rather than as databases. Access to information, I want to follow up on what Steve was saying. Access to information is such an abstraction, right? It sounds like, okay, well, there's this recipe for the thing, the anti-diarrheal formula, and we pass that along, right? There are those kinds of examples. But mainly what people use communications tools for is communicating. Right, and this has always turned out to astonish people, right? When the mobile phone companies moved into data services, they said, oh, it's going to be sports scores and the weather and all of this other stuff. And it turns out, no, in fact, the phone is really good for talking to other people. And when you add data services, that's what they do as well. SMS caught them by surprise, even though they're communications companies. Very often, the information we want access to isn't information about something, some piece of abstraction up there. It's very personal, very social, very situated information, right? Imagine two people, Sebla and Tedessa, who are, for some reason, uprooted. They end up in different environments, you know, possibly a refugee environment. You can imagine all kinds of situations that would cause people to scatter. What they want to know isn't what's happened to my village or, you know, how can I get fed where I am. What they want to know is Sebla wants to know where's Tedessa, and Tedessa wants to know where's Sebla, right? That the amount of lateral information that moves across these environments, which doesn't look like database stuff to us, but to people in that situation, matters enormously. The other thing is that communications among groups of people builds up social capital, which is a kind of invisible glue that lets people get things done. And so if you take two groups of people, one of which doesn't really communicate except around really important matters, and the other of which communicates around really important matters and also gossips, right? In a crisis, the second group will function better because they'll know each other better and they'll trust each other better. That social capital turns out to be a byproduct of seemingly non-essential communications. So back to this, right? I've drawn this as people, although obviously there's a lot of what we're talking about is an interaction between people and machines. So we can essentially bring it down to nodes and links, right? This is the gram. What I've got up here is the absolute basic unit of communication. A message passes from point A to point B, right? So once you've got that, because if you don't have that, you're not communicating at all. Once you've got that, what else can you do? One thing you can do, this is supposed to turn around, but somehow this isn't loading. One thing you can do is you can see if you can make it a conversation. Right? Instead of just thinking about getting information to go one way, can you make it a feedback loop? Right? The tutoring conversation we saw on the screen in Steve's example is a perfect example of that, right? We're adding the full round trip. You're looking at information coming in. What can I give back to the person giving me that information, right? It's just make any arrow you would draw one way, two ways. Second, can you broadcast it? Somehow the slides are not loading, and I am sorry about that. Maybe I will draw. I'm tempted to draw on this screen, but I won't do that. No, I got it. I'll do it. No, it's all right. Yeah, it's right. It's. I'll just use the whiteboard I do have. So one of these, as people in my class know, it makes me physically ill to draw nodes and lines in the same color. One of the things you can do if you've got information moving from point A to point B is how many points B can you get, right? Which is to say, can you just broadcast information that was previously coming in one way, right? An astonishing number of services on the web have taken advantage of this pattern. Flickr, Delicious, all of these patterns where you're either sharing photos or tags have said essentially, what's going to happen if I make the information that's flowing implicitly social? I say there's a bias towards sharing. You can turn it off if you want, but you can share. And the surprising answer is if you make sharing the default, well over 90% of the participants will share. Right? And so suddenly information which only was passing from point A to point B starts to appear in large aggregates. And with large aggregates, you can do things like start to make a market, because all of a sudden, enough people know what enough other people know that there's some social convergence that doesn't exist when you're just dealing with point to point. Oh, yeah. And of course, now I have to advance the slides just to see which order I put these in. Okay. You can also start with multiple points A and have it move to a single point B. So this is the third possible operation, which is, can you aggregate it, right? Can you take information that's flowing from all over and put it in one single spot? Now, to this question, very interesting earlier about web versus mobile. Think of a bridge. Think of two bridges. Imagine the Brooklyn Bridge. Imagine a drawbridge, right? The Brooklyn Bridge has a lot of infrastructure on each side of the river, and the bridge is just built across the river, held up by two giant pylons. With a drawbridge, all of the engineering, all of the infrastructure is on one side, right? That's a cantilever pattern. So one of the interesting things about, so in fact, I think it's a not just a mistake, but a potentially catastrophic mistake to say web versus mobile. Right? Because in fact, if you use the field, if you use the phones in people's pockets to produce the information, but you use the web to aggregate the information and rebroadcast it, the fusion pattern works better than you can only have PCs or you can only have phones. Google, for anybody who hasn't seen this, this is such an astonishing thing they've done. They can detect flu outbreaks by the number of people typing in flu symptoms. Right? And they have so much data that the dirtiness washes out of the system. Right? If you look at an individual typing in flu symptoms and said, oh my goodness, we must dispatch Tamiflu to that community, right? You'd be wasting your time. But when you can do that times a billion, suddenly the signal becomes incredibly clear. And they've mapped it to the signal produced by the CDC. They get the flu outbreaks in the community exactly right. The only difference is CDC gets them 6 weeks late. CDC isn't actually doing biosurveillance, they're doing bioaccounting. Center for Disease Control, this is a US-centric thing, pardon me. The Center for Disease Control can tell you, oh yeah, a month and a half ago, a lot of people in Atlanta have the flu. Google can tell you about a day after it starts, right? So that's a place where lots and lots and lots of little aggregates, again, to the question about web versus phone, lots of aggregation of really lousy data turns into really good data. At some central point. Fourth, I will draw everyone's reporting experience from the field. Here's headquarters. Here is you. You know what happens. Right. I don't even have to tell you why this isn't such a great pattern. Right. Operation four, can you take this kind of pattern and multicast it, which is to say when the information moves, can you just have it go every place it needs to go at the same time? Regional office still gets the report, headquarters still gets the report, but they get it in the same burst. So instead of it being aggregate, post-process, resend, aggregate, post-process, resend, which adds time while it squishes out signal, right? Can you broadcast it to specific targets in a way so that when a report goes out, everybody who would touch that information is getting it at the same time? And finally, and this gets, I think, to Steve's point. Can you host a conversation? Can you convene? Can you be a place where instead of being a hub and spoke system, a lot of people look to me for information, and then I give information to each of those people in turn. Can you say what Steve said exactly about the government, which is, can I put these people in a conversation with one another? And I'm sorry, I didn't catch the pronunciation. Was it Zambino? The Mexican?
Zambido.
Yeah. That's exactly an example of this pattern. Taking 10 people and putting them in two-way conversation with each other in a group accomplishes something that you can't accomplish in any other way. As Steve very sweetly said, I've written a book called Here Comes Everybody, which is about social software. And one of the absolute home truths about that underlies that book is that groups behave differently from individuals, and that the value you can get out of being a convening platform for groups is very high. And I think that a lot of I'm looking at the development world from the outside in, so I'm not the person to talk about projects that are going on in the field, but I have spent quite a lot of time now reviewing existing projects. And one of the things it seems to me that characterizes a lot of the successes is taking the latent connectivity. Everybody's got a cell phone. Everybody's got SMS. Everybody can do call completion or what have you. And saying, I can take those communications patterns and I can perform some of these operations on it. I can broadcast the data. I can aggregate the data. I can convene people. I can multicast the data. I can make it conversational, which is the final. Oh, yes. And of course, right, you can mix and match, which is to say you can have a group talking, and then you can broadcast the results. Or you can aggregate something in a database, hand it off to somebody, and then they can put it on the radio so everyone can hear it. And critically, right, for this last pattern, let me send it away. For this last pattern, these can be cell phones. This can be a web server, or an asterisk server, a phone server, and this can be a radio station. Each node can do what it does best. So again, to the very interesting question at the end of the first session, a degree of hybridization of these patterns often does things that individual patterns can't do. And to the Yu Shahidi question, the place to add new technology are where there's a small number of nodes. And the place not to add technology is where there's a large number of nodes. As we say in my class, any expense times the African population is a large expense. So don't imagine new stuff here, but new stuff here can often make the difference in a lot of bridging patterns. So with that, I'll end. Questions or comments about that? Okay. Grant, would you come? Join us. Thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Grant Cambridge. I'm from Meraki Institute at the CSR in South Africa. And I come from a development environment. Okay, my original background is guided missile systems, from the explosives to the rocket propellants to the guidance systems. I've now changed that knowledge into something useful, okay? Project called Digital Doorway. Okay, we're starting to build up instead of break down. In keeping with the theme of this afternoon, I'm going to do something completely different, okay? I come from Africa. I'm proud to come from Africa. I'd be very happy to go back to Africa. I'm going to give you a reality check, okay? Everything that was said this morning was fantastic, okay? The gentleman from VIA picked it up for the first time and said, hang on, guys, what we were talking about with Web 2.0, Education 2.0, all of that is designed for Western civilization, okay, where you have broadband. Okay? In an African context, life is tough. Okay, there are some statistics. Okay, majority of people in rural Southern Africa have never seen a computer. Okay, so how are you going to teach them, give them an education, if they're using Education 2.0 or Web 2.0 applications, if they've never seen a computer? Okay. The reality is, your rural village, okay, the education quality there is as good as your teacher. Okay. Unfortunately, we have cases where teachers simply do not rock up to work. And you have parents standing in for teachers, okay? So your ability to learn is limited by the teacher, okay? And it is a scary thought. If you've got a lousy teacher, forget it. You're not going to learn anything, okay? Some of the rural areas, your world is as big as you can walk in 8 hours, okay? Geography, okay, there's a field there, there's a clump of trees there. That is your geography knowledge. Majority of the kids have never even heard of America, okay? Which is an interesting thought. Cellular technologies. Everybody's talking about cellular technology. And yes, I saw a report this morning that for the first time, South African cellular penetration has reached 101.8%. Okay, which is, yeah, interesting. Okay, I guess it depends on how you calculate it. Some of the realities. Those cell phones are hand-me-downs. Okay? Some of them are reasonably good. Some of them are really terrible. Okay? We have cases where people are actually skipping meals because the cell phone is seen as a status symbol. Okay? If I have a cell phone, I'm able to communicate. Communication is one of the basic human requirements. Okay? But that status comes at a cost. Skipping meals, people having to walk for several hours, several times a week, simply to charge the cell phone because there's no electricity in the village. The changing in education. Okay. Education is based on respect. Okay. If you do not respect the person who is educating you, you're not going to learn. Okay. It's a bi-directional thing. You cannot stand on a stage. I think the popular thing is a sage on a stage. Okay. It's moving away from that. You're moving from an education was the original theory behind education was, oh, we're going to teach you this just in case you need to know it. Okay? We're now moving to just in time. Okay? You're only going to need to know this when you need to know it. Okay? How do you get that respect? Okay? And it's difficult questions. It's not a simple answer. Some of the challenges we face. Rural environments. Okay. My boss moaned me a couple of months ago because I insisted on buying 5 drill bits to go to a site. She said to me, why do I need 5 drill bits? I said to her, if I take one and I break it, I have an 8-hour round trip to the nearest hardware store. Okay. That is our long way. Okay. Challenges in maintenance. Okay. You put this beautiful high-tech equipment out there and it breaks. Okay. You can't just send somebody out there. The distances are vast. Okay. The directions that we get sometimes, one of our sites up in the northern province, a place called Makuva, we went there the first time, and the guy sent me directions. He said, you go through, take the first dirt road off. He says, there used to be a sign there, but somebody stole it. So look for 2 short pieces of steel sticking out the ground about the same width as the sign. Go through the first ditch. Okay, the first ditch, if you didn't have 4x4, you forget it. You're not going to get through it. They refer to it as a ditch. Okay, it almost swallowed the car. He says, get to the third village along the road and turn left at the big tree. Okay, we arrive there. Hey, all the trees are big. Okay? These are the sort of challenges that you face in deploying technology in Africa. Okay, the dust, the heat. One of my site managers told me the other day that it's not only heat. Okay? They had a minus 36 degrees C temperature a couple of weeks ago. Okay. One of the other problems with technology is vandalism. Okay? That's one of our systems that somebody managed to break. Okay? The screen used to be there. Okay? They actually smashed the screen right through. Okay? They've also broken the keyboards. Now, these are probably one of the toughest keyboards you can get in the world. I took that keyboard and I sent it back to the supplier, and he hasn't spoken to me since. He was convinced that his keyboards were tough. The digital doorway. Okay, for those of you interested, there's one upstairs, just around the corner from where you guys had lunch. Okay. The concept of the digital doorway, how do we get people information literate? Build computers, put them in specially designed steel cases, make them rugged, make them as vandal-proof as possible, put them out in the field, and then study how people learn to use computers. Okay. The scary thing is that in villages of 5,000 people, we did a survey, 2 people had heard of a computer. Okay. Heard of a computer. Nobody had ever seen one. Okay. Nobody knew what an automatic telemachine is. Never been used. We put on a system. Within 7 days, the children had developed a language to describe what they were doing on the screen. Okay? Because in a rural village, there's no such thing as an icon. There's no such thing as a mouse pointer. Okay? In most rural villages, a mouse is a snack. Okay? It's not a pointing device. The system is rugged. It's been designed to be rugged. And the incredible thing is, based on Dr. Sugata Mitra's hole in the wall, okay, this project has exploded in South Africa. It is really, really powerful. And to see how the kids teach themselves to use computers, become literate. Okay? English, most of the content on the system is English. It doesn't seem to worry them. Okay? A lot of the games are simple maths games. The advantage of putting a system like this into a rural village, coming back to the teacher scenario, is that you're actually starting to push the teachers to improve their knowledge. Before Digital Doorway, the teacher used to say 2 + 2 = 5. The kids had no reference point. They've got no way of arguing. They're now starting to argue and say, hang on, Tux Maths says 2 + 2 = 4. Okay? And quite honestly, they believe the computer more than the teacher. Okay. We have had sites where they've actually had to switch the computer off during school hours because the kids refused to go to school. Okay? Because they reckon they were getting a better education teaching themselves as opposed to going to school. Some basic system design philosophies, stock standard, hardware equipment, okay, designed to incorporate as much of the new hardware as possible. Okay. As with any technology, sort of new stuff lasts about a week. After that, it's old stuff. Okay, so we're starting to adapt, starting to convert the systems as well. Further developments. On the side there is a container, yeah, self-built container. It's a flat pack that can be put on the back of a truck, solar paneled roof with 3 Digital Doorway terminals inside. Okay, it's very, very light. It's made out of steel with a foamolite insert. And literally, we hope within about 2 days worth of work to install the thing, assemble it, and get it running. The one on the side there is a single terminal Digital Doorway. Somebody mentioned this morning that the kids have access to school labs. Okay? A very small percentage of the kids actually get in to use the computers. Okay? And a large number of the computers run Windows. And the content leaves a little bit to be desired. Okay? So this was designed to be bolted outside the school, provide content to the computers inside the lab, as well as provide access to people in the village. They didn't have to go into the class to get the work done. In terms of some statistics, we've had people walking 8 hours to access the computer. Okay. We have 200 sites around the country which are extremely heavily utilized. Some sites have been reporting a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week activity on the terminals. Some last thoughts. Access does not imply inclusion. Okay? It's a very, very interesting thought. Just because you can access information doesn't mean that you're included in the big conversations, as Clay was mentioning. Thank you very much.
Questions? Yes, sir. All right, can we get a mic in the back here?
Paul Molinaro, UNICEF. The thought of these the children coming around the portal and self-teaching, how do they regulate themselves in terms of who has access? I have a hard enough time with 2 children having access to 1 terminal fighting like cats and dogs.
In the beginning, it's and quite often started off by physical size. I'm bigger than you, so I can use the computer more often. One or two of the sites have actually regulated it, specifically at schools, where the headmaster has stepped in and said, like, you know, Monday mornings the girls can use it and Tuesday mornings the boys can use it. But the majority of sites actually self-regulate themselves. Because they're open 24/7 and accessible 24/7, the people actually just get along. Okay. One of the most powerful things with the Digital Doorway is the concept of group learning. Okay, we have a I mentioned it earlier, Tux Maths, which I don't know if anybody knows it, but it's a maths game. It's freely available, open source, and it's mental arithmetic. And what we typically find is that you get a penguin flying a spaceship through space, and a maths problem floats down from the top. And you type the answer in and you hit the space bar, and if it's the correct answer, he pulls out a laser gun and blows it out the sky. And so it's a real cool game. It's got lots of eyes, lots of lights, it's got lots of noise. And what we find happening is one or two children will operate the keyboard, typically one on the numbers, one on the space bar, and about 10 will stand behind screaming answers. Okay? You multiply this by three terminals, it can get chaotic. Okay? But the great thing about it is that when they get something right, the entire group learns. Okay? It's a complete mindset shift in terms of education, where the kids are actually educating themselves and educating each other, as opposed to the sage on the stage standing talking to kids.
Can we get up? Oh,
My name is Noel. I do consulting work. One of the amazing things that I'd like to just point out real briefly is the fact that governments within the United States still have a lot of road for this type of innovation for participatory societies. And yep. As of 12:30 today, New York State government is soliciting ideas for how to close the budget gap from all of the internet. So if you go to nybudgetideas.org, anybody in the world can take a look at the New York State budget and figure out how to close that the billion-dollar deficit that the state has. And I'm kind of happy about that because that's one of my little pet projects that I've spent a few nights working on. But one of the things that I find interesting within the New York State technology community, which I am quite active in, is the way that we've been able to build an ecosystem where it becomes a sustainable community, where we're mm-hmm. able to go to each other, and whether it's Wikis Take Manhattan or whether it's all the tech art communities, that we're able to cross-pollinate ideas and conversations. But, you know, we're the largest city in America. We're very technically savvy. We have the benefit of broadband. How do these approaches in regards to skill sharing, especially dealing with advanced technology in communities where the educational system is more focused toward agriculture, not necessarily technology. Mm-hmm. What steps have been done, particularly within South Africa, as you two can speak much about it, or anywhere else in the world, to build those types of sustainable technology communities in these rural agricultural environments?
What we're actually working on at the moment is we're starting to move into the whole social networking, Facebook, Moodle, Crabgrass type scenario, but with a very specific focus in mind. The digital doorway is about education. It's about educating kids. It's about educating adults. We're very, very hesitant to, number one, connect to the internet, okay, because of the costs. In South Africa, internet costs are typically 300 times higher than anywhere else in the world. Okay, and I think, Steve, the telecom's version of broadband is 3 gig cap a month, which is ridiculous. But in terms of actual speed, I think it's about 420 kilobytes per second. Okay, that is South Africa's definition of broadband. The other interesting thing is, in terms of internet connectivity, we've had a couple of sites where we connected the internet, and we found that the user base shrunk. Okay, all of a sudden, instead of 3-year-olds to 93-year-olds, we now get predominantly male 14 to 18-year-olds, okay, surfing the web for what I suppose they deem educational sites. Okay. The minute we disconnected the internet, all of a sudden, the user base broadened. Learning started to occur. Okay, so it's very dangerous to associate internet access with the ability to learn. All the content is hosted locally. We also have several clusters in South Africa which are connected via Wi-Fi. And we have basic chat programs so that the kids can start chatting to each other. The social networking side, we're just starting to experiment with it. Looking predominantly at things like community bulletin board, where you can put community notices up and everybody can read them, a jobs board where you can advertise, say that I'm a skilled painter and I'm available and this is my cell phone contact details, or you're looking for a plumber. A couple of other things we're looking at and toying with, which would be a little bit more challenging, is a community wish list. There's a lot of donors in the world that have a lot of money to donate. Yeah. But if you donate to your traditional big charities, you're not sure exactly where that money's going. And so our concept is, let's put up a community wish list where the community can say, listen, to make our lives a lot easier, we're going to need a water tank and we need a borehole. Somebody sitting in Europe and then say, hey, hang on, I can sponsor that. And they channel the money directly to that village. The village then goes and gets the tank and gets the borehole dug and puts the pump in and everything, and then takes photographs and publishes them back. Now, that makes the assumption that we have reasonable internet connectivity. Okay. At the moment, we're using GPRS, which is like kind of slow. Okay. It's reasonable for text-based stuff. But until we get an affordable, reasonably broadband internet connectivity, it's incredibly challenging.
Down in front.
Hi, I'd like to know the cost of setting up such a program and who pays for it?
The cost and?
Who pays for the program?
The average, the digital door, the traditional sort of three-seater, which is upstairs, you're probably looking at about $7,000. Okay, that's all the hardware, the software, all the bits and pieces. In South Africa, we primarily funded by the government, the Department of Science and Technology. We're starting to work now with Department of Education, Department of Communications, and a couple of the private foundations. And basically, you know, sort of, the big challenge is getting enough of these things out there. That's always a major challenge. And basically, you know, the cost of the program, well, how much money have you got? We can spend it all, promise you.
The question down front here.
Thanks. Robert Kirkpatrick from Instead. Just a quick question. I mean, and it gets on the point that was raised earlier about sustainable development communities, perhaps not even requiring the internet necessarily. And, you know, sustainability often means how do I support my technology in the field when I'm gone, rather than how do I give the population I'm trying to serve the capacity to continue to adapt the technology to challenges they'll face in the future that none of us can anticipate. And I'm curious, you know, you're seeing these kids go in a very few days from not knowing what that object is to interacting with each other and with the software. Sooner or later, they're going to start hacking.
Absolutely.
And in a very good way. And I'm wondering, you know, how open is that system and what kinds of innovations have you seen from the kids? What are they asking for? What are they trying to do? How are they participating in the requirements discussion and what's coming forth from that?
Excellent question. On the Digital Doorway homepage, we have a feedbacks tab, okay, which allows kids to send us a text feedback via GPRS. And we're getting some incredibly valuable requests. Bearing in mind that at the moment on the project team, there's a project manager, there's a software developer, and there's me. Okay?
Yeah.
Three people. Okay? One of the first requests we got back was that we've got tons of content on there. We've got three versions of the Wikipedia, we've got 10,000 Project Gutenberg books, we've got science, we've got videos, we've got games, everything. And the first, man, I think it was about the second day after we implemented the text feedback, somebody said, hey guys, how about a dictionary? Good idea. None of us had ever thought of a dictionary. So now we're looking for a decent offline open source dictionary to put on there. Okay. In terms of the hacking stuff, I mean, brilliant. That's what it's there for. We've got some real nice innovations which allow the kids to, there's webcams in each of the modules, and they can start the webcam and then they can click, take a snapshot, and that becomes the desktop. We also have a Bluetooth connectivity so that they can take a photograph of themselves and then connect their phone and download whatever they've created onto their phones as desktops or... Yeah. The original idea with the Bluetooth was that the cell phone would then become a carrying device. So you could type a document, put on the cell phone, take it to a printer, print it, and pay somebody a couple of cents a page. In terms of the hacking stuff, the first one that we put in Mamelodi, which is just north of Pretoria, was a Debian-based system. And we put it in, and I think we went back about 8 hours later, and one of the kids had figured out how to take a photograph of himself and put it as the wallpaper. Okay. In terms of the software on the system, we have almost like two separate partitions. The one is guest users, okay, and you can go in there and you can log in as a guest user and you can do anything you want. You can delete icons, you can move icons, you can change backgrounds, everything. Randomly past midnight, we log out and we recreate the entire guest user back system. Okay, so all your icons are back again, all the bits and pieces, and anything that you've saved as a guest user has been deleted. Then, as a guest user, you can also create your own user. So you log in as yourself, and you can wreck your own system, and we leave it alone. Okay? And if you don't like it anymore, well, you just create yourself a new username, and we've got the space to do that.
Okay, great. Thank you, Grant. John and Yamina, can you guys give us clean sheets on the Flipboard?
Okay. Here's what we want to do with the next hour and three quarters, which is as you heard from the representation of questions in the room, just the cumulative experience and brain power in the room is pretty extraordinary. So what we want to do is figure out some way to get everybody to cluster in relatively small groups and to spend some time working on ideas that are interesting enough to make a difference but practical enough that you could imagine building them in the next 1 to 3 years. There's some obvious themes that have come up from Steve and from Grant. People could cluster around rural access. They could cluster around novel hardware for the field. They could cluster around participation, education, and so forth. But I want to ask you all, before we put up, because what we'll do is we'll just put up a big word on one of these boards and just get people to sort of congregate where those topics are interesting. Is there anything you've heard where you think, I want to think more about that? There's a big topic there that we've gone over. Yes, ma'am. Hacking in the third world, okay. And I should also say, what's that? Great. We also have several people from the design community here, and one of the themes that I think is implicit in a lot of this work is design is R&D. Not have an idea and at the late stage think, oh, we ought to bring in a designer, but rather using design as a way to think about usability. Which I think has been an implicit theme in some of these things, so we can put that up. So I guess, Yamina, can you put up hacking in the third world? Thanks. Let's just do design as R&D. What else? Anything else? Yes, sir.
Community mapping,
say more.
Wasn't replaced by a peer group in the community when absent, perhaps by a parent. Mm-hmm. Why haven't they figured that out when you've actually shown it so brilliantly in your
topology
unit diagram?
So would the idea behind community mapping be figuring out different kinds of patterns that could? So you can imagine education as a broadcast pattern. You can imagine education as a participation pattern. You can imagine getting people to come and aggregate things as they're doing on grants. Oh, I'm sorry, that kind of mapping. I keep thinking topology instead of geography. Got it. Yeah. Can you put community mapping down? There was a question behind. Yes, sir.
Reimagining supply lines.
Yep. So let's just put down supply chain. You can take this one. All right. Okay, so we'll put that down. Great. Yes, ma'am.
Bridging the divide between mobile and AR.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, yeah.
Looking at voice, data, yes,
right. So let's transmedia. Okay, we're 21st century now. Transmedia. That's great. Thanks, Yamini. Yeah, Chris.
Involving people with different or disabilities.
Okay. Excellent, John. Assistive. Right, assistive tech and involvement. Great. Yes, sir. Right. Could that be linked with the transmedia idea, which is to say the idea of the sum, the whole being more than the sum of its parts? So let's wherever transmedia is, let's add plus synergy. There was a couple. Yes, ma'am.
Building on the stuff that Steve said, mobile educational software, so right. Java applets or software that's mobile-based
great.
That can add sort great. Of what's available.
Education plus mobile. Yes. Oh, sir, Greg Hag. Yes, sir. Designing for low literacy. Excellent. Yes, sir. Grant, you want to...
We've talked about this already, but I mean, it's the same
thing. Can we, instead of fast-forwarding to ubiquity, can we say dramatic improvement in connectivity? I mean, having seen Erica's maps of connectivity in Africa, to take that as a, you know, as an example. But let's say, rapid improvement in internet access. Sorry, yes, ma'am. Safe participation. Okay. Yes. Great. I'm sorry. The lights are a little glary. Yes, sir.
Participation of decision making, whether it's government decision making and service delivery or development programs.
Right.
How do we get
what Steve was talking about with his round trip example for
ways that sort of recognize the existing social right. structures and mesh with them instead of working across.
Right. Working for participation. Yes, sir.
I would say actually.
Great. Yes, sir?
Kids education.
Nice. You mean, can you get kids education? Yeah, Chris?
I just had also like
Cloud sourcing. Oh, Web 3.1b. I can see it. I can see it coming now. Can we add that to kid-to-kid? Can we make it so it's peer-to-peer and sourcing? Well, but I'm not sure that you're not just focusing on education with the governance question. Is that right? Yeah. So the agony here is that it's people are going to clump around these things, and if we have, you know, two dozen, we're going to have groups of two. But whatever, we'll keep going. Yes, sir. Oh, that's interesting. Why not? Great. Nice. Yes, sir.
I'm curious about putting kid-to-kid under sort of wide area network versus local area network. And the idea that Grant was saying of taking the internet out of the equation entirely.
Yeah. Can you add that? I mean, kid-to-kid is turning out to be a big topic. Can you add local plus global? Local and or global? Great.
That actually goes to the digital island, like local internet.
Yeah. Yeah, the local island thing is a really interesting observation. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I'd like to look at Facebook for Africa. What's it going to look like? So,
you mean, can you do Facebook for Africa? Great. Yeah, good.
The role of institutions in the developing world, government, private sector.
So,
who is going to do all that? I mean,
right.
Because we are in the New York technology lab.
Mm-hmm. Right. So
you need to have someone to impulse, to
So is there a particular, because in a way, I can imagine different financing models depending on which of these problems we're sinking into. Is there a particular issue you've heard either from Steve or Grant or from this where you think that problem is especially acute? So you mean, can you do institutions and funding? Let's take a couple more. Yes, ma'am, in the back. Yes. Yes. And that's related. What? How do we have that up there already? That's yes. This is the question of assistive technology for participation, trying to bridge. I just want to make sure that it, what do we have? I thought we had one other. Yeah, assistive technology and involvement. Right. Okay, good. Let's see if there's any more. Okay, so here's, I'm sorry. Yes, ma'am. Yes, okay. Let's add it to that rather than open UK, which is to say, I think the assumption in the room is whenever we're talking about a technology, we're talking about fusion rather than replacement. So let's add PCs to the mobile piece. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. Big stack of note cards up here. They've got a white side and they've got a side with lines on them. We're going to go over these topics. And I'm going to ask you all to just stand up, move the chairs back, and go stand next to the thing you're most interested in. If it's just one or two people, we'll find someplace else. If it's too large a group, we'll subdivide you so that we're in conversational-sized groups. And what I'm going to ask each group to do after going around and introducing yourselves to each other is to come up with three ideas that you think as a group, and it doesn't have to be consensus. Three ideas that you think could be implemented or that it would be worth exploring. Yes, ma'am. I think everything that I had said has come up again. I was throwing those out. New hardware shows up in several of these. We added design as R&D, and then participation, role, and education. So I think they've been reflected unless you think we're missing something. Political participation, I think, is with this community mapping, the idea of driving for involvement. So, John, can you read out what you've got?
Education, mobile competencies, design as R&D, community mapping and decision making.
Okay, hang on. Actually, since I've got the mic, can we get a handheld mic? Yeah, thanks. Just give it to. You know what? I'll just do it since I'm okay. So, education with mobile and PCs is there. Design is R&D. Community mapping and decision making. I don't have any tape. I'll just use that. Is here.
Safe participation. I don't think your mic's on. Sensitive environments.
Safe participation, sensitive environments, and these signs are really just to get people to clump. So why don't you? Why don't you all stand up? Let's move the chairs back. Assistive technology and involvement. Yeah, thanks. So just start clustering around what's interesting to you. Kids' education, hacking is here. Sorry. Facebook for Africa. Sorry. I thought I was under your camp. I thought I was under your lens. Here, let me see if I can back it up and away. Yeah, put that up somewhere else. Institutions and community mapping. So let's. Okay. So what are you guys are just going to decide where you're going to land? Just look
we're
around?
We're just going to, like, fine. Go to it.
Okay. All right. Very good. Okay. Thanks. All right. So you guys are for the educational piece. Is that right? Great. No, unfortunately. We can't audit. I mean, are you at NYU?
I'm not a student.
Okay. You would write to, just write to information at itp.nyu.edu. But right now it's in the middle, we're in the middle of the class, so, because we started in January.
Right, so. I'm like, I'm going to be the only one.
Okay. All right. You guys are at Facebook for Africa? Okay. You guys are at Institutions and Community Mapping? All right. Okay. Are you guys going to join a group?
We are a group.
What's that? You are a group. And what's the...
We're the key team.
Okay. So...
Either that or mapping.
Mapping. Okay. All right. So... That. Hey, Yamini, where's that going? There's already community mapping over there? Okay. Yes, there is community mapping. It's over there. So go...
But is it
go.
Also
yes. Those two were put together. All right. Are you guys going to join a group?
We're trying to figure out.
Okay. You guys going to join a group?
Yes.
Okay. I don't know. I just you should take a look and see what you like. I just want to get people together. All right. So what is this cluster? Is this design as R&D? Who's for design as R&D? All right. Great. Let me get you guys started. Okay. Excuse me. All right. So were you guys all safe participation? Yes. Okay. So. All right. Thank you.
Yeah, on the 26th.